Well, good morning, everyone, and it is a real pleasure to be with you here today. Rather than beginning my remarks with phrases with which you are all too familiar, I will simply come out with it. Advertising, as we have known it, is going through hell. Then again, as Winston Churchill said, if you're going through hell, keep going. So, we'll do just that, and let's take a look at the advertising and marketing and media business and understand what kind of battle we're in and why. Let's take a look at what this hell means and what we're going to do about it. Looking at the 18 months we just left behind us, that's probably what we should be most grateful for, is that they are behind us. As the financial markets imploded, and some of Wall Street's bellwether firms like Lehman Brothers and Merrill Lynch and Bear Stearns were left for dead or sold in fire sales, as one individual made off with other people's money to the tune of an astonishing $50 billion, a Ponzi scheme whose scale topped the Enron disaster. In the US, Detroit's big three individually and collectively faced bankruptcy or bailouts as retailers' decorations for holidays were destroyed by the worst shopping season in decades online or off, and as America's unemployment rate soared to levels last seen in the 1940s, the marketing, media, and advertising business fared as poorly as could be expected as a result not only of the general economic conditions surrounding them, but as a result, too, of specific changes and challenges associated with technological innovation and resulting consumer behavior. And in our interconnected world, all pain is shared. As the World Bank noted, the financial crisis that erupted in September of 2008 has become a global crisis for the real economy. As an astounding $14.5 trillion of the value of the world's companies, one-third of the total, has been wiped out as stock markets lost between 40 and 60% of their dollar values. All three of Iceland's major banks failed, the largest banking collapse of any country in economic history, as calamity battered Spain, now home to 3 out of every 10 unemployed people in Europe, or 18% of the country's working population, as even heralded emerging economies were bloodied, like Russia, where the domestic automotive market is so enfeebled that Nielsen predicted it will fall back to 1980s levels, and China and India, which both suffered sharp, sudden drops in their growth rates, and as Japan's industrial production, just January of this year, tumbled by 10%, the largest monthly drop since the country first began keeping records. Now, given these bleak pictures, it is hardly surprising that declines in the shares of the four global advertising holding companies were nothing short of dramatic in 2008, as WPP slid 52% year over year, IPG 47%, Omnicom 41%, and Publicis 29%. Major media companies are experiencing similar losses in value. In February of this year, 5 of 19 media stocks hit 52-week lows. Much of the media company's woes have to do with the reality that advertising simply can't support all the media that's out there. Simply put, media properties and media spending opportunities of all sorts are proliferating and advertising dollars are shrinking. Yes, advertising dollars are declining. The final numbers are not in, but most expect final U.S. advertising spending in 2008 to have been off between 2.5% and 4% from 2007. But the stunning, mind-boggling, horrifying, sobering, scary prognostication is industry economist Jack Myers. Jack's outlook is that ad spending in the U.S. will experience declines for 3 consecutive years from 2008 through 2010, the first such plunge since the Great Depression. And even the Depression drop-off was a 2-year decline. 3 is unprecedented. His forecasts call for a 2.5% drop for 08, 6.7 decline this year, 09, and a 2.3 decline in 2010. And others predict similar drops. If Meyer's predictions become fact, that means that over $25 billion in U.S. ad revenue will be lost to media companies between last year, this, and next, and $56 billion will come out of marketing communications in total. And of course, globally, the advertising outlook is only slightly less dismal. While observers do say that for many marketers, the tumbling has stopped, there is still a long way to go. What is also proven to be fact is that we in interactive advertising are not recession-proof. Our growth rates, while certainly far healthier than any other media segments, did not materialize as advertising, as advertised, so to speak. Internet advertising, according to PwC and the IAB, grew 15% during the first half of 2008 and 11% during the second half. For this year, projections are all over the map, but eMarketer, which aggregates others' data, is projecting a final increase of 8.9%, down from the 11% growth it forecast for 2009 back in August. As Barry Diller, the CEO of IAC, puts it, anyone who thinks about growth in the next few years is delusional. That's pretty tough. So what are we supposed to think about in light of all of those dismal statistics? Well, I would guess that we have to think about innovation, exploration, inspiration, introspection, reinvention, perhaps. I would guess that we have to think about re-energizing, rekindling, reviewing, revising, renewing. As WPP head Martin Sorrell told the Wall Street Journal a couple of weeks ago, the advertising industry can return to what it was, but it's not going to be the same. It's not going to be in 30-second TV ads. It's not going to be in newspaper or magazine ads. It's going to be in Russia, India, China, Vietnam, and digital. So, we have to do a lot more than think. We need to move, and fast. Cisco's CEO John Chambers said of his experience, failures almost always occurred when we moved too slow. And Diller says, swiftness is the prize. Back in the day when we were launching DoubleClick, we said the same thing, but we phrased it this way. Speed kills if you don't have it. But how and where do we move quickly? What do we do in this environment? If innovation is, as Harvard Business School's Michael Porter says, the central issue in economic prosperity, are we in the interactive advertising industry innovating as we should be? While advertising is never going to be the business it was, advertising is still a business about the art and science of persuasion, and I would now add participation. So the art and science of persuasion and participation. While for years the business seemed to err on the side of art, I now think it errs on the side of science and math. Even at conferences billed as advertising events, technology and technological innovation have in recent years taken center stage at the expense of issues that can equally, if not more so, accelerate the growth of interactive advertising. Where is the creative innovation in advertising? Where is the innovation with brands? We're measuring everything under the sun because technology allows us to. But are we turning data into intelligence and consumer insight that agencies can use to create spot-on messaging and that marketers can use to develop their relationships with consumers and therefore build their brands? Are we doing enough? As I and others have bemoaned, are we in danger of commoditizing our inventory before we have established its value proposition? Have we moved forward the needle in the last year? The question, perhaps, boils down to whether we are focused on directing our energies and other resources toward those issues and activities that will drive growth for the interactive advertising industry. There are many points of view here, of course, and significant debate about the issue of science and math taking the lead over more classic content and brand development activities, often summarized in questions major companies like Yahoo or AOL ask themselves: are we a technology company or a media company? Just a few months ago, the headline of an article in Media Week read, "Blinded by Science? Buyers Ask If Microsoft's Ad Focus Is Marketing or Math," referring to the appointment of Dr. Chi Lu as president of Microsoft's Online Services Group. Yahoo's choice of Carol Bartz, a longtime software executive, as its new CEO prompted similar debate. I am heartened to know that Tim Armstrong, in his new role as CEO of AOL, aims to become one of the world's largest producers of digital content and the leader in display advertising. Following the recent search agreement with Microsoft, Yahoo's Bartz announced her company would also return to a focus on content and display or brand advertising. And MySpace is also returning to its roots, reclaiming leadership in the global pop culture space by focusing on music, gaming, and entertaining. I think this will yield positive results for all of these companies. As an industry, however, and this has fascinated me for about 15 years now, why do we feel the need to be so either or, black and white, binary, zero sum in our thinking? In order to accelerate the growth of interactive advertising, we need to be more focused on what we are trying to accomplish at the end of the day. It seems to me that so often the debate creates lines in the sand that are not only artificial, but also serve as blockages to our progress. It's similar and connected to the debate around, are we a direct marketing medium or are we a branding medium? Those who focus more on science and math often declare that direct response is what online is all about for marketers, while those who have marketing and media backgrounds tend to highlight the web's branding abilities. But if we are in the business of communicating, promoting, and selling marketers' products, why do we feel the need to choose between direct response and branding? How could you most effectively sell anything if you don't use both? Is it an either or is it an and? In a recent blog, or clog as he calls it, USIAB CEO Randall Rothenberg writes, "In our obsession with immediacy and accountability, we have overlooked the more subtle, yet more powerful ways that companies, brands, and fortunes are built through time." He notes that, as committed as he was to the principle that advertising must sell, Ogilvy also understood the risks posed by fixation on immediacy and accountability. I think it's relatively clear why the scales have tipped toward math and science and direct marketing myopia if we look at the short history of the interactive business, which we'll do in a second. But if we look at the sheer masses of people who are online in 2009, it's a vastly different picture than that of the mid-90s when this industry was birthed. And it would make sense, to me at least, to consider that as we debate. When we first went to market in the mid-90s, the proof of viability was the click-through. We had little else to help us put ourselves on the map. And the direct response of a click made us look like, well, a direct response medium. With the explosion of search and Google's rapid-fire rise to the top of the list of most fascinating and innovative companies in the world, the focus on the medium's ability to deliver on classic ROI metrics contributed to its settling in to the performance advertising medium. Funny aside here, when I was running sales at Yahoo, one of the tech executives once called display advertising non-performing advertising. Those were some of the battles we had to overcome, and I think sometimes we're still overcoming them. But as technology continued to facilitate our ability to target audiences far more specifically than offline media has ever afforded, and as we developed better technologies and mathematical equations to target consumers by behavior, these new opportunities created a level of fascination for technology that pushed it to center stage in the discussion. While display advertising was exploding into the billions of dollars at companies like Yahoo, the attention was on technology-driven and automated ad solutions versus how to leverage technology in a creative marketing environment. Interactive advertising seminars and programs and conferences hosted speakers who talked about reducing friction in the system, but almost none helped marketers understand how to create compelling advertising for this new and different set of channels, and how to do that using the consumer insight that is the output of the massive reams of data with which we are blessed. Users were being treated to dancing cowboys and animated insects crawling across their screens, not quality creative that helped brands effectively communicate their messages to the growing masses online. As algorithms and direct response metrics prevailed, ad networks emerged, and with them, another challenge to branding and brand marketers. Some networks and exchanges provide real value. They aggregate large audiences, addressing the scale issue important to so many marketers. They offer publishers a way to monetize inventory that would otherwise become perishable goods. And they offer a variety of optimization and other measurement tools of particular interest to direct response advertisers. But with most of them emphasizing low prices and tools, they have contributed significantly to a dramatic drop in online CPMs, over 50% drop, without contributing to the value proposition of online marketing for brand advertisers. While it is undeniable that measurement and accountability have become more important to marketers than ever before, and while it is also undeniable that technology has provided new and different ways for us to account for ad spend, some believe that there's a strong case to be made that an overemphasis on measurement or on limited kinds of measurement may be holding back our growth. Andy Atherton, who's the COO and co-founder of BrandNet, wrote a commentary on MediaPost entitled "Online Branding: The Top of the Funnel is More Important Than Ever," in which he made the point that while we have the ability to easily and economically provide measurement of brand metrics online, we are not focusing enough on it. He writes, "The vast majority of retail commerce, nearly 90% overall in 2008 and much higher for key brand categories like CPG and automotive, still take place offline. Thus, for the majority of marketers evaluated based on their success in driving offline sales, it's a bold statement at best and simply false at worst that interaction rates or clickstream data or repeat visits to a website are more useful metrics than proven tools like brand awareness favorability, purchase intent, or even reach and frequency for that matter. These metrics are certainly not perfect, but they are tested, well understood, and comparable to metrics from other media." Now, if Atherton is right, and we focused on using these well-understood metrics, we wouldn't be subjected to headlines screaming, "Brand marketing is dead," which really and remarkably did run in MediaPost, or to read, as we have begun to recently, about the demise of display advertising. I don't, for 1 minute, believe it. I believe that this is an and medium, one brilliant for direct response and brand advertising. But we need to better assist brand advertisers who decidedly have gotten the short end of our attention stick. On an Advertising Week panel last fall, Babs Rangaya, the Director of Global Communications Planning at Unilever, made the point that if an ad's creative execution doesn't drive demand. Targeting and a strong media plan aren't going to rescue the campaign. He said that the highest quality creative is more important than ever in a cluttered and fragmented media world. Can anyone really disagree with that? Bob Greenberg, who's chairman and CEO of agency RGA, says, the digital age has redefined what it means to be a brand. If you agree with that premise, then I think you would also agree that the way a brand communicates with a consumer has to be redefined as well. Greenberg says technology has created multiple entry points to engage with a brand. This shift in interaction has increased the necessity of smart digital branding, but there's still a misguided view of how to effectively brand for the space. In the past, branding was largely about creating corporate identities to help people understand what companies symbolized: global or local, bold or refined, serious or whimsical. These elements of a company could be derived from the logo, typeface, and colors used on everything from its letterhead to its advertising. Many branding companies are still following the same set of rules used to make those brands famous. Those rules may have worked effectively for decades, but times have changed and branding today has evolved to mean so much more. Today, they're fluid, flexible, and nonlinear. There are many new questions we need to consider. For instance, what does the logo sound like? How does the text move? How can we experience, draw an emotion? And perhaps most importantly, what are consumers saying about the brand? As Alan Adamson, who's managing director of branding consultancy Landor, wrote in Ad Age, in this transparent, audible, shareable environment, there are more ways than ever before to find out what matters to consumers. There's absolutely no excuse for not listening to what they think and how they feel about products and services. All true. I agree. Easier said than done. And you know that. But I contend that we owe it to brand marketers and to ourselves to work closely with them to understand how exactly to extract consumer insights from the online world and how to create brand advertising that resonates in this environment. We are at the very beginning stages of understanding how to leverage the phenomenon called social networking, a growing part of the fabric of our everyday lives. Are text ads and direct response metrics the key to unlocking the magic here? I don't think so. But neither do I think that most forms of known creative will prove to be the answer either, as advertising as we know it seems to be in a social media environment not only intrusive, but also to cross the line to disruptive. If we are going to grow this industry, we have to help marketers stop interrupting the conversation. We have to help them be the conversation, and that requires more than technology or a direct marketing solution. It requires enormous creativity. It requires that interactive publishers engage with creative agencies and digital agencies and reclaim marketing. It requires that mainstream agencies embrace creative technologists and integrate them into their creative departments. We err mightily. We do serious damage to our nascent industry if we leave marketing to some of those price-pressuring media agencies and price-cutting publishers who malign and devalue our quality content. Our myopic focus on performance and direct marketing only must stop now. Rothenberg writes in his Clog, advertising inventory can be written, designed, and produced by immensely talented creative people into communications that drive the fortunes of great companies. Can be, but for the most part, isn't. Given the remarkable creative potential in interactivity, online media should present a cornucopia of fabulous, effective, and effective advertising. But direct marketers are almost defiantly disinterested in the aesthetics of communications and the long-term impact aesthetics have on brand value and company activities. We need to become an and industry, focusing on direct marketing and brand advertising. Growing this industry also requires the intelligent use of data, not data for data's sake, but data that we can turn into consumer insights that help all of us unlock the power of the web. Insight need not only inform where and how commercial messaging is directed or targeted, but also that insight can inform what the message is. In other words, data turned into insight can and arguably should shape the creative. That's not a new concept by any means for marketers or their agencies. What's different today, thanks to technology, is that we have far more data that we can turn into insights, and we need to leverage its creative messaging that causes us to be more successful in pursuing and persuading the consumer to become interested, involved, engaged in brands, ultimately leading to sales online or off. Thanks to technology, we can create a more precise approach to marketing and advertising. But as you and I know, it's not all science because it's not always concise or precise. Data alone is not going to design and perfect the creative for us. And it's not going to assure that we create a successful brand experience and ultimately a successful ongoing relationship with our consumers. There's art here, literally and figuratively. Again, it's the art and science of persuasion and participation. As ad critic Bob Garfield says in that same piece, to create a genuine bond, an intimate relationship, requires a thorough understanding of consumer behavior, consumer interests, consumer sentiments, consumer moods, consumer movements, and so on. This requires what Sherlock Holmes called deduction. Also, a bit of extrapolation, inference, intuition, divination, prediction, and imputation. Or put another way, guesswork, he concludes. In my words, informed gut is okay too. In other words, brands are good for brands. So take informed creative, intelligent placement in an appropriate environment assisted by data, but placement not solely driven by science, and now you're talking. Art and science, persuasion and participation, there's room for all of it. The beauty of interactive media is that we are not relegated to just persuading or just selling. And we should not allow anyone in any part of our collective media, marketing, and advertising industries to relegate us to one box or another, to an either or. We are an and. We can, unlike other mediums, market products and services all the way from introduction and awareness through to the sale. We have the capability to accomplish all that marketers need, and we should not tolerate those who put us conveniently, lazily into an old traditional box, or those who would hide behind math and science's so-called logic because they fear the less disciplined art and gut and creativity and expression. Yeah, they fear it. And we should fear those who have never been to a museum and those who claim to know what marketers want, but who have never met a CMO or stepped foot inside an agency. It's irresponsible if we are to grow this industry not to take charge and make room for the and. It is incumbent upon us as leaders to not allow the technology and advertising worlds to collide, but rather we need to urge collaboration. We need to leverage technology for all it can do to help marketing, but we cannot cede marketing to technologists. Brands and branding must battle back. Again, I cite Rothenberg, who suggests our seller-buyer-driven culture is devaluing not just the pricing, but the potency of our medium. We must start acting like the makers of magic that the best of us are and always have been. Yes, makers of magic. Commercial messages that hold the power to persuade and compel consumers to participate in our brands and ultimately to buy them. We have the full power, the power of and, branding and direct response. And as we move forward, let's not focus on half the opportunity, but rather the full suite of solutions we have to offer to marketers. Thank you.